what you're saying. You recall when they came in and tried to tear up the house of the Lord?
Yes.
And the Bible said Jesus came in there with a whip,
yes,
and tore the church up. I mean, he preached and tore it. I mean, he tore it up.
Yes,
he came in there with a whip, and he wasn't trying to hit the devil. He was hitting people. Now, I don't encourage you to go and find no whip and hit them for. Because somebody said, Pastor didn't say hit nobody. But let me say this. Listen, no one has the right. Come on, Pastor, say no one has the right. No one has the right to walk over you. And because you let people know that they've offended you does not mean that you are wrong. Because here, listen, sometimes folk will offend you, and many times folk may not know they're offending you.
Amen.
And if you don't express to them what's going on, then they will think that this is just how they are.
Right.
You see, there are some people who just have a way of, how do I say it nicely? I can't even figure out how to say it nicely. But there are sometimes people have this proclivity to just be a little rough around the edges. Can I say it that way?
All right.
And sometimes when a person is rough around the edges, what you call rough for them may be just their normal.
All right.
One of the things we did when we were going through marriage ministry was that even in marriage, if you don't express to your spouse how you feel, then they won't know how you feel if you don't give a verbal description of how it feels.
Right.
And so one of the things we use was a thing called texture. Come on, just say texture.
Texture.
If I were to speak harsh to her, she would say, now baby, that felt like, no, that was a little rough. That felt like concrete. That felt like sandpaper.
All right.
Which means that bruised me, it scratched me, it scarred me.
All right.
And so we have to be able to relate to people in areas a way that they can relate to you. But now, on the other hand, there are some folk who will attack you because they think you are weak.
All right. Tell it.
Look at the person by himself and say, don't get it twisted. I'm not weak. It is in those instances when people attack you, you have to be bold enough to speak up for yourself and tell them, that's not what I'm on.
All right.
Amen, somebody. No one has the listen. God never told us to give up our right and let folks walk on us. Amen. And so you have to be willing to let folks know. Now, I'm not saying do it with attitude. Or somebody said, put your attitude in your pocket. But you have to be willing to do it in love. Pastor, how's that? Brother, listen. I really love you. I hear what you're telling me, but right now what you're telling me is really getting on my nerves. Amen. Right now I don't receive what you're telling me, and I'll appreciate it if you would stop. Amen. See, the Bible said, follow peace with all men as much as possible. Which means then there are some people that you just not going to get along with. I'm sorry, let me go deeper. There are some church folk. Somebody say church folk. There are some church folk you just not gonna get along with, Brother Rich. And so, in that retrospect, you have to love them and keep moving. Amen. I've learned to love folks and keep moving just because I know that you don't love me. Don't mean I have to tell the whole church that so-and-so, they're plotting against me, and I know it. See, one of the things I understand about God, when folks are coming against your life, God will let you know. And because I don't speak up don't mean I don't know what's going on. See, sometimes silence can be golden. Pastor, what you're saying? Jesus, you all gave us the perfect example. Watch this. Jesus knew that Judas was his enemy. But watch this. Jesus embraced him. Even in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Judas came to betray Jesus, Jesus not one time let on that Judas was the culprit. But watch this, he embraced him, he kissed him, and called him friend. Let's back up some. Even in the upper room. Now, Jesus said, one of y'all here is going to betray me. Now, you know and I know that Jesus pointed out Peter.
Oh, my Lord.
Peter would have cut him like a fish. Come on, friend, talk back to me. Peter would have, if Jesus said, all right, now check this out. The guy who's going to do it, this cat right here. Because he had John on one side and Judas on the other side. Had Jesus said, hey, Pete, right here. Peter would have tore him apart. But watch this. Jesus held his peace, knowing that Judas was the one. And watch this. Jesus allowed him to go out, do what he had purposed in his heart. He said, what thou must do. Watch this now. He said, do it quickly. And the others, watch this. The others stayed behind us. And the person said, Lord, well, maybe it's me. Not knowing that the real culprit had just got away. See, sometimes you can know who did it.
All right.
But because you know who did it, it's not a carte blanche to go and attack them because you know that they're wrong. Watch this. The best thing to do is to pray.
That's
about time to say pray. Because when you pray, listen, when you pray, you can bind the hands of the enemy as you pray. Amen. And the will of the enemy will not come to fruition if you just pray.
All right. And then I'll
get to the word. If people are hurting you, let them know they're hurting you.
All right.
No, listen to what I tell all our leaders. If you can't treat the people in this church like I do, then I don't need you leading.
All right.
Pastor, what you're saying. If I don't cuss them out, you don't cuss them out. If I don't holler at them, you don't holler at them. If I look on them, you look on them. If you can't duplicate what I do, then I don't need you leading. Simple as that. But let's get somebody on this. Jesus said, love them, watch this now, even as I have loved you. This is a requirement that I require, especially in this house of all the leaders. You love the folks in this place is the same way I love you. If I love them, you love on them.
All right.
Don't let folks just come at you any kind of way. You sit there and say, well, I'm a something for the Lord. No, they ain't something for the Lord. Sometimes you got to just address the issue the way it is. Okay.
Right.
How many of you know that sometimes you got to speak up for yourself?
All right.
Amen. Just call the thing out, call it like it is, and then this way it'll stop.
All right.
Because if you don't let folk know, folk will keep on doing what they're doing to you. Amen.
All right.
They will. So you have to be willing to call it out, put it on the table, cut some water, please. And put it on the table and let them know, listen, because I'm saved don't mean I'm dead like that.
That's right.
That's right. Because I'm saved, thank you. Don't mean I'm dead. Amen. Yeah, one time asked me, he said, you're a preacher, right? I said, I sure am. The Bible said to turn on the cheek, right? I said, it sure does. Reggie said, if I slap you, what would you do? Brother Thomas, everything in me. You know, see, my dad told me about it and said, if a guy given that arm reach, punch him first. I'm just saying what I'm saying. I'm old school. If you in my territory, I'm going to swing first. He said, if I slap you, and Red, he was coming toward me. I said, brother, I'm going to tell you this. If you put your hands on me, it's going to take God. I'm saying what I'm saying. It's going to take God. You better know how to plead the blood. You better call on angels. Hope God hold my arm up, because if God don't hold me up, it's coming down. I'm putting all this 230 into that one shot. I'm saying what I'm saying. I'm going, y'all judging, pray for me. I ain't Jesus. How somebody said, pray for pastor, pray for him. Amen. Now he said, I thought you were saying, I said, brother, I'll be just as saved while I wake you up. I'll be still full of the Holy Ghost when I wake you up. I get some smelling salts, some water. We wake you up. Praise the Lord. Yes, Lord. It's going to be on. And so Listen. And so I thank God for that question. Listen, you don't have to let anybody walk over you. It does not mean that you are any more holier because someone walks over you. Amen. Now, let me add balance. Come on, can I say balance? The Bible said a false balance is an abomination. There are times where God may want to work something out of you.
That's right.
Because if you got a bad attitude, see, watch this. Just like God uses people, the devil uses people as well. And if there's something in you that God wants to get out of you, watch this, that test will come through people.
Yes, it will.
That's what you're saying. If it came through your dog, you would kill a dog. If it came through a roach, you would spray it. Came through a spider, you smash it. But it comes through people. Come on, class, say it comes through people. And so if God, listen, always ask the question, is God trying to work something out of me? Because if God is trying to work something out of you and you don't let him, you'll see some things over and over and over. Amen, somebody. Because you can change living arrangements, you can change churches, you can change blocks.
All right.
But if the problem is you, you can never escape you. Hustle like them saying you can't escape yourself. Because when all is said and done, you gotta look you in the face every morning. You know your issue.
That's right.
I like how Chuck will get real solid. Look at somebody, tell them, say, you know you got an issue. You know you got an issue. Yeah, you do. It is. Yeah. Listen, it is not, see, because if you don't realize you have one, you think everybody else is the problem. But the problem could be you. And you spend your life angry at the world, saying, nobody like me. First of all, you don't even know everybody. And until you realize that the problem could be me, you always want to point the finger at other folk. But you have to look at yourself and say, all right, Lord, is it me? And God, if it's me, God, show me me. Now, I'm going to tell you that now. When you say it, it's a setup because it's in reality. If you ever ask God to show you yourself the way he sees you. Let me try that. Say, Lord, show me myself the way you see me. Boy, if God ever show you the way how he sees you, you find out what you think you wrong, right? You find out how short you come. But watch this. It should provoke you to have mercy on other folk. Amen. I pray that message, after the question, give God a hand, praise right back to me. Glory to God, cut me off. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Listen, y'all, can we give our committee that did a great job on yesterday? Come on. Let me personally thank all of you who worked so hard and so diligent to make that event on Friday night a great success.
Amen.
Those of you who didn't come, God bless you. We had a good time anyway.
Amen.
We had a good time anyway. Amen. We really, really did. And this is not a condemnation. But let me encourage you all. Listen. Somebody said, we're family. Let me say this. If we don't support each other, now, this does not apply to you. Give me some money, please. This won't apply to you if it's not you. But if we don't support each other, how can we grow? How can we get to the next level? Thank you. If we don't support what we do here. Tell the person by saying, we must support what we do here. Listen, if we are family, and we are, if we don't support what we do, see, one thing I've learned that folk will pull you out of what you do.
All right.
They will pull you out and turn you away from the very ones, the place that God has sent you to.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Amen.
Amen.
And we'll do it in the name of friendship, not realizing that if I invest someplace else, then my home is lacking.
All right.
Amen. If I can say it like this. If your mortgage is due and my mortgage is due, as much as I love you, I'm going to take care of my home first. Because that's the Bible. The Bible said a man who don't take his house is worse than an infidel. Amen, somebody. But I believe that folk will talk you out of doing the right thing, and you will do it in the name of friendship, or maybe because make you mad at your pastor. I'm cool with that. But if you are going to be a part of something,
yes,
then support it wholeheartly.
Right.
Hustle my them to support it wholeheartedly.
Support it wholeheartedly.
Amen. Listen, you will not come to me to pay you, but you work for somebody else.
All right.
Come on, you can go to GMC and ask for a check, but you work before.
That's right.
Maybe it's just me.
That's right.
Amen. And so hear me, family, let's make sure we take care of home. Amen.
Amen.
Because, listen, we cannot accomplish what God has called us to do if we allow other folks to pull us from the place where God has set us.
All right.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We cannot do and fulfill the vision of God in this house if we allow other folks to pull us from what God has called us to. So we have to make sure that, listen, when folks want to pull, now, let me get this right. Don't think that I'm saying don't support other ministers.
Amen.
Somebody say, that's not what I'm saying. Pastor is not saying that. Because I support other ministries.
Amen.
I do. I send big money to other ministries because I support kingdom business.
All right.
But, Tracy, if you have something in the house, and my friend, Pastor Tony, has something on the same day, because I'm part of the house, I'll be here in the house.
All right.
That's right there.
All right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. How somebody say, that's only right. Amen. Because we are a part of the house. Listen, y'all, family, when I was coming up and told, hey, they said family stick together.
All right.
Amen. How somebody say family stick together.
Family
stick together. Amen. Amen. Are you all ready for the word?
Amen.
I pray that you write family all of it together.
Amen.
1 Timothy chapter number 6, verse number 12, and 1 Samuel the 17th chapter. As a matter of fact, let's just go to 1 Samuel 17. We'll forego 1 Timothy 6. We'll just look at 1 Samuel the 17th chapter. Look at verse number 30. When you're there, say, I have his word. 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter. What is that? In the organelle? Okay. Is that you? Okay. 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter. Look at verse 31. And then say,
I have his word.
Verse 31. And when the words were heard, which David spake, they rehearsed them before Saul.
Yes.
And he sent for him.
Mm-hmm.
And David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail him. Wait a minute. David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him.
Mm-hmm.
Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine.
Yes.
I'm in verse number 33. And Saul said to David, thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for thou art but a youth, and he is a man of war from his youth.
Yes.
Help me preach today. Look at the person back and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
We are still winning in impossible situations. Lay your hand on yourself and say, I win
in
impossible situations. Let's pray. Father our God, and again we thank you for this time of sharing your word. Thank you for that you have afforded us this opportunity, God, to teach your word on this morning. Father, I pray now that you would strengthen my body from the crown of my head to the sole of my feet. God, God sent it today, a special type of anointing. That I may deliver, God, to your people what you've given me today. I bless you in advance in Jesus' name. I pray. Amen. You may have your seat in the presence of the Lord. Glory to God. Now, let me first make sure I'm in the right house. How many of you all believe that it is the will of God for you to win, no matter how impossible that situation? Nurse, but in terms of say, I win, no matter how impossible it may look. Come on, say, say I win, no matter how impossible it looks. Hear me, child of God. This needs to be the resolve of every born again believer.
Amen.
That you win.
Amen.
Hear me, preach to class, say, I win.
I win.
Understand, we win in every situation.
All right now.
No matter how difficult, no matter how insurmountable the situation may appear, understand, child of God, you win.
All right.
Now, let me make this 100% clear. I'm not saying that death is your winning track. I mean, you live and you win.
Oh,
yes. Somebody say, I live and I win.
I live.
See, many times we use death as an option and say, well, if I die, well, I still win. Yes, death, you still win. But I mean, you win and you live and you win.
Right.
Somebody say, I live and I still win.
I live.
Glory to God. Amen. Now, again, this must be our mindset that we are winners no matter what we are facing. What causes us to fall into the area of unbelief is that we judge whether or not we can win based on the impossibility of that particular situation. But understand, the Bible says that God, all things are possible. Come on, let's say all things are possible. Come on, say it again. Say,
all things
are possible
for me.
Come on, Pastor.
All things are possible
for me. Say it again. Say,
all things are possible to me.
Hear me, because this is what you must get in your spirit. I don't care what it is you are up against, no matter how impossible it may appear. Nothing is impossible to you. The Bible said anything is possible if you can believe. Come on, how many folks believe today in this house?
Yes.
Somebody shout and say, I'm a believer. In Matthew, the 14th chapter, verse 24, when the disciples found themselves in panic mode, here they were out there on the ship and they were in panic mode. Come on, class, say panic mode. How many of you have ever found yourself in panic mode? That's called desperation. That's called a place of anxiety. Here's the question. What causes us to be in panic mode? What causes us to be filled with anxiety? It is the impossibility, thank you, the uncertainty of the situation. Because we have this tendency, all of us just want to know. But watch this. Trust me, there's some things you don't want to know until you need to know.
All right.
Pastor, what you're saying? Because watch this. There's some things that you may know that will stress you out so much the devil will give you a heart attack if you're doing the things.
All right.
Besides me, anybody that God don't tell you everything you must know. Listen, if God told me at 20 some of the hell I would go through at 50, I said, Lord, you know what? You can take me right now and get it over with. Maybe it's just me. Come on, somebody. But God doesn't tell us the whole story. But over the course of our lives, he allows things to be revealed to us. Watch this now. But watch this. Even as things are revealed on a need-to-know basis, he is strengthening us for every part of the journey. Come on, let's say God is strengthening me for every step of the journey. Come on, let's say God is strengthening me for every step of my journey. Understand, family, you have to know that God is strengthening you for every step of whatever journey you are coming across. See, watch this. Shark, the one thing I love about God that maybe it's new to me, but it's not new to God.
All right.
Ooh, that's a good Make a shout right there. Just because it's new to me does not mean it's new to God. And if God knew, family, it was coming, then God has this. Thank you, Holy Spirit. God has. Watch this. Many of you all are more prepared than what you already know. Because when you face things in your mind, you're saying, you're like the disciples in panic mode. God careth not that we perish. But God said, I've given you all this word to build up your faith. I've given you word on every Sunday. I've given you word on Wednesday. I've given you word on Tuesday. I've given you all this word to help build up your faith. So when this thing came up in your life, you should have had enough faith for the journey. Let somebody say, I have faith for the journey. See, watch this. A boxer, yesterday I was watching a program called 30-30. They were showing the pre-fight preparation for Roberto Duran and Sugar Ray Leonard. And they showed these brothers, y'all, how they prepared for the fight. I mean, they had a fight date. But then, 3 months before the fight, these brothers were in the ring, I mean, working out hard. And some of the stuff I seen them do, Brother Mom, was it messed me up. These cats were having folks punch them on purpose in the stomach. You know why? Because over the course of their fight, at some point, they were going to get punched in the stomach. They had folks punching them in the head. You know why? Because over the course of that fight, someone was going to get punched in the head. But watch this. Also, they have them practicing how to duck. Because sometimes over the course of your life, you got to find a way to either duck or block the punch. And so for 3 months, they were trained with rigor. They were trained hard. They were running. Now, Pastor, the question would be, why did the trainer have them running? Watch this. To build up their endurance.
All right.
Here is where I found out that many Christians, why they fall off or by the wayside.
Okay.
Because before the fight, they never build up their endurance. The Bible said to be steadfast. That means to have endurance. Be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Simply saying this, that before you enter into a fight, get in practice. Get in training. Because listen, y'all, winning is not automatic. First, somebody say winning is it automatic.
No.
Child of God, you have to prepare to win.
Yes.
Oh, I said, God, amen to that. I said, you must prepare to win.
Yes.
First, somebody say, you must prepare to win.
You must prepare
to win. Now, many Christians, y'all, don't prepare to win. This is why I understand what the devil keeps us so much garbage in church. He keeps us fighting among each other. So watch this. When something hits one of us, no one has enough power to break the back of the enemy.
All right.
Watch this. Imagine this. Mr. Lewis, how can I pray you through when I just finished talking about you?
All right.
Can't happen.
All right.
Ain't no power flowing through me.
All right.
Yeah, Mr. Price, right. You know that old mother lady over there. Look at her. You know, look at her. You know. Chuck, look at her. I'm really going to look at her. Glory to God. But watch this. You want to have, listen, what kind of team of soldiers would we have if the Navy SEALs didn't like the Army soldiers?
All right.
If the cats who were jumping out of airplanes couldn't thank the guys who were in the ship? Come on. And if our armed forces fought against each other instead of with each other? But watch this. Have you ever noticed that every branch of our armed forces, they know exactly where everybody is at on ground? So before we fire a shot, we know where all our men are. But watch this. In God's house, it's a thing called friendly fire. It's bad to get friendly fire in God's house. Can you imagine, Pastor Marsh, what would happen to the boxer if the trainer in his corner in the middle of the fight decided to give him some strychnine?
All right.
See, watch this. What got Pete Rose banned from baseball was not that he didn't like baseball.
Right.
What got him banned was that he was betting for the wrong team.
Yes, sir.
You don't have a bet against your own team.
No, sir. No, sir.
Come on.
All right.
Now the boy, what's this? The boy got over 4,000 hits and can't even get to the Hall of Fame.
No, sir.
Because he placed a wager against his own team. Listen, how can you win a fight with the team, but don't fight for the team?
All right.
Somebody tell him, say, we can't win.
We can't win.
If you and I fight each other. Hear me, Lord. This is what the devil wants to do.
Yes, sir.
Now watch this. The devil wanted to call the disciples to start fighting against Jesus.
That's right.
Lord, don't, you know, watch this, y'all see. We read it, Lord. Careth not to let me perish. Now, you know, and I know, if I'm in a storm and I'm panicking, I don't talk like thought. Lord, you don't care that we're going down?
All right.
Okay, let me say it like you all told your kids when they clean up the room. See, watch this now. what you don't see.
Yeah.
Yeah. Somebody tell him, say, he sees
what you don't
see. See, Isaiah 45 said he declared the end from the beginning. Which means, what this, which means he has already seen the whole plan. But you're encouraging somebody to say he's seen the whole plan. See, what this, one of the things I run out of y'all and replay, sometimes they have what's called inconclusive evidence.
All right.
Which means we know you fouled somebody or did the wrong tackle.
All right.
But we can't prove it.
All right.
We can't prove you did it, but we saw it happen, but we can't prove it. Right. There's no evidence to overturn the call. But watch this. God sees everything, watch this now, in its conclusive state.
Yeah.
In other words, let me say it like this. On the replay, they have what's called a zoom lens.
All right.
Which means if a guy step out of bounds, they can zoom right to his foot.
All right.
And see whether he was jazzed on the line or had a little bit over.
Yes.
Now watch this. You can go over a small tidbit and still be out of bounds. But watch this, y'all. God have a zoom on your life.
He can pull a
close up on your life. And you may think that your life is heading out of bounds. And God said, no, I'll keep you in bounds if you keep your hope in me. And turn somebody and say, you keep you in bounds if you keep your hope in him. See, watch this. Understand, children of God, your hope is only in the Lord.
In the Lord.
Come on, declare that. Say, my hope is in the Lord. Now watch this. It's in the Lord no matter who hands it come through.
Right.
I say your hope should be in the Lord no matter whose hands it come through. See, watch this. If you need a blessing of money, I don't care if God used somebody I like or somebody who I can't stand. Watch this. If God want to get something to me, God can let a drug man drop it.
Right.
Let a dog think it's food.
Okay.
Bring it in front of my house when he realizes it's not no food.
Right.
Let me come out the door and steal the bag. Pick the bag up.
Yes.
I got a bag full of money. Y'all ain't funny.
Yes.
I don't care how it comes. If God has it for my life, I don't care how God gives it to me.
Yes.
See, watch this. There was a story of a man who was on a Greyhound bus. He was down on, as the world say, down on his luck. He was broke. Didn't have no money. All he had was a bag of greasy chicken.
Right,
you know how to do that. You know, road trip. Get some chicken, some bread, some fries.
Yeah.
Here was, this cat was on the bus. Somebody who was across from him kicked the bag over to his side. He's already mad. Already depressed, and down his luck. He kicked the bag back over to the man. Because, you know, he's already mad, already depressed, and down on his luck. The man kicked the bag back over at him. Now he's really mad because he's depressed, he's broke, and he's down on his luck. He kicked the same bag back over to the other guy. Because he's mad, he's depressed, he's down on his luck. The man kicked the bag back at him, and now he's really mad. people, situations.
Amen.
See, because once you are the enemy, how he wins is he causes your emotions to be unstable.
All right.
He comes to turn your emotions upside down.
Yes.
Come on, any of y'all, how many of y'all ever had surgery before?
Oh, yes.
Surgery.
Oh, yes.
How many of y'all ever, they said you might have surgery, and you was like, oh, no. How many of y'all ever heard of folks who had surgery and you like, and then they didn't make it out of surgery?
Oh, yeah.
All right.
And the moment they told you that you had to go through it, watch this, your mind went to forget the person who made it out of it.
Right.
You were right to the person who didn't get through surgery.
Uh-huh.
All right now.
Who cared that 25 million folks were alive and one died? The enemy will turn your whole emotions upside down.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
Pastor, why? To get you out of faith.
Uh-huh.
Push the person in front of you and say, stay in faith, stay in faith. See, watch this, y'all. This is where the power of confession kicks in.
Yes, it is.
Come on, Pastor, the power of confession. This is where the power of confession kicks in. Because the devil wants to get you to say the wrong thing, but you must speak your end while you're at the beginning.
Right.
Come on, Pastor, I'm going to declare my end while I'm in the beginning. Come on, Pastor, I must declare my end in the beginning. Listen, this is why it's important you can't just let your mouth say what you feel. Y'all ain't talking back to me. I said you can't let your mouth say what you feel. Listen, all of us sometimes we say, well, you know, I'm just saying what's on my mind. Sometimes you ought to shut your mind down. See, what's now? Because, listen, there are times, y'all, where the devil be talking so loud, and watch this. It is so easy to bring your emotion, your thought process in line with what he's saying.
Yes.
You know why? Watch this. Because what he says sometimes makes sense.
All right.
I heard somebody say one time, they said, if it makes sense, it's probably not God.
All right now.
The devil deals with your sense knowledge.
Yes, he does.
But the Bible says that just live by faith. And so if you and I, man, are faith people, our job is to live by faith. Watch this. Not what someone else says or statistics, but what does the word of God have to say about this situation?
All right now.
See, watch this. In our text, here it is. It is no doubt that Goliath, who is the giant, is not coming against the armies of Israel.
Right.
Uh-huh. Now, watch this. Imagine here you all. Here it is. Israel has an army. Now, these guys are farmers, sheep herders, you know. Heavy men, builders.
These guys
are not warriors.
All right.
They weren't trained for battle.
Not at all.
Here they are, all these days in confrontation with the Philistine army.
All right.
We have what's called an impasse or a standoff.
Uh-huh.
Now watch this. Someone said, you know what, check this out. Instead of all of us getting killed, you send out your best warrior, we'll send out ours.
All right.
Now watch this.
Right now.
Isn't it just like the enemy to hit you with his best shot first?
All right.
Come on. See, you think that, well, God, how come this? Listen, the devil, if he wants to get your life into unbelief, he is more effective if he get you with what you believe is his best shot against you. Soldiers in the Philistine army, why did they send out Goliath instead of somebody else?
All right.
Anybody ever heard your saying say, pick on somebody your own? Why send out a guy who's 10 feet to fight me in my 5'5", 130 cell?
All
his sword, I mean, I'm sorry, his spear was weighing around 200 some pounds, just his spear. His shield was at least 350 pounds just for the shield. His armor was about 200 pounds. Now, if the boy can hold, well, first of all, they folks were carrying his shield for him. But if his armor is 200 pounds, the guy himself must weigh at least 500 pounds.
Wow. Oh, yes.
He's a big boy.
Yes.
Come on, Pastor, he's a big boy. Now, if this, oh, there you go, right there, look at that. Now, y'all looking at that? That's a big boy.
Yes, it is.
Uh-huh.
In reality, David is no match for the big boy.
All right now.
The devil will send you his best shot first. To make you believe you don't have no match for the big boy.
All right.
Hush somebody and say, but yes, I am.
Yes, I am.
The Bible says, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world.
Yes.
And so even though you may look small on the outside, somebody in me is bigger than what's on the outside.
Yes.
Somebody said, it's more in me than on the outside of me. Child of God, you better understand that you have more in you than what you see on the outside of you.
All right.
How somebody tell them, say, you are big on the inside. Now watch this. Some people have giants they fight, giants called depression. You fight giants of loneliness.
All right.
You fight giants of abandonment.
Yes.
Now I'm going to go deep right here. Some of y'all are still fighting giants of unforgiveness.
All right.
Oh, can I park there for a minute?
Yes, sir.
Some of y'all are still fighting stuff that happened to you a long time ago.
All right.
Watch this. Some of y'all are fighting stuff that the person who did to you been dead a long time ago.
All right.
They've been dead and you still hold up on to the stuff that happened to you years ago.
All right.
And here's the hard part. You're holding on to stuff, and somebody is paying for something that someone else done in your life.
All right.
That one I'm going to say again. I said somebody is paying now for what someone else did in your life years ago.
All right.
And you're taking out your bad disposition against the person who's really for you because of what somebody else in your past did to you.
All right.
Somebody going to say, you got to let it go. Let me tell you why I'm here. Since I said I'm dealing, and it's lovers weekend, so I can go here. Listen, if you were in a previous relationship, I don't care what he or she did to you. You don't let no one hold you hostage based on what happened in your past. Watch this. How can God bring you a new boo when the old boo still lives there? I'll say that again. I said, how can God bring you a new boo when the old one still stays there? Watch this. How can God unlock your heart when the person who holds the key is still in you? And if I were you as a man, I refuse to compete for your heart with somebody you won't let go. Because what is the moment they do something that resembles what somebody else did, you gonna go off on them when they didn't do it.
Right.
Heard somebody say, let it go.
Let it go.
And some folks have this giant in your life is called unforgiveness.
Uh-huh.
Come on. Listen, since you can't erase what happened, don't let what happened hold you hostage. You think in my life I enjoyed everything I went through? No. But can you imagine if I held hostage everything folk ever did to me? I'd be mad at a whole lot of folk. How many of y'all have more than two folk do you know?
Oh, yeah.
Come on. How many of y'all, if you held in your mind all the folk who ever did you wrong, your mind would never get any rest?
That's right.
And there are many of God's folk, y'all. They are because and the cloud wouldn't move, it was God leading them.
All right.
Had they stayed where they were and the cloud would move, what then? The cloud was designed to cover them but be a guide by day.
All right.
When the cloud would move, if they didn't move, what then? The sun would have killed them in the desert.
All right.
Many of you all are dying emotionally, you're dying spiritually because God has moved and you're still stuck. I've given you power over all the power of the enemy. and start questioning why I sit here and die. Come on, if I'm going to be in a fight, I may as well open up my mouth and say something. That's what Bible says, say something. Amen. Why sit there and let the devil keep beating up on you and you don't chatter what he's telling you? Come on, family. And he's bombarding your mind, making you think you can't win this battle. But what's it, y'all? Break it down. Every battle is winnable. Well, that's worth shouting right there. Every battle is winnable. Would you push somebody to say, every battle is winnable?
Every battle is winnable.
Question, but do you want to win? Come on, do you want to win? Ask somebody, say, do you want to win? Watch this. Look over in verse 25, over in 1 Samuel 17. Your first resolve is this, that there are giants that must die before you are able to enter into the provision of God. Yes. Come on, can I say, giants must die before I can enter into God's provision. Like it should be in 1 Samuel chapter 17. Look at verse 25. Are you there? Yes. And the men of Israel said, have ye seen this man that has come up surely to defy Israel? As he come up, and it shall be, watch it now, that the man who killeth him, the king will enrich him with great riches, and will have his daughter, watch this now, and make his father's house free in Israel. All right. That sounds like a winning situation. Pastor, what you're saying? They said, see, God already had a blessing in store for David.
Yes.
Isn't that right? But watch this. David could be concerned about how he got blessed. There are paths that God will take you through to get your life to the blessed state. David's overflowing abundant harvest, watch this, had to come through Goliath. See, watch this. His harvest came through the thing that looked impossible to overcome. Imagine this. If I win the battle, I marry the king's daughter. Everything the king leaves to his daughter comes down to me. But watch this. I don't just get blessed by myself. If I win the fight, my father's house goes tax-free. And everybody in the house gets to live good for free. Okay? Y'all the devil, I'm going to say it like this. The battle you are in right now could be your place to debt cancellation forever. Because God wiped out all the debt Jesse owed by the battle David won. David's house got free. Jesse's house got free because David won the battle. Watch this. I wonder who's in your house. Who's hooked up to you? Maybe not you, but maybe your children, your grandchildren, maybe your grandchildren's children's children. But if you stay the course, God will bless your offspring because you made a decision to stay and win the battle. Turn to mind and say, I win the battle. I win the battle. Now watch this, class. Watch this. In verse 26 now, watch this. David did not compare the giant to himself, but compare the giant to his God. You cannot base your ability to win off of you. Maybe it's just me. Listen, you know already in your own power you can't win. But when I have Almighty God backing me up, I win not in my own strength, but in the strength of God. See, the Bible says, his strength is made perfect in my weakness. So when I'm at my weakness, his strength in the strong is for me. Somebody say his strength. to say? He picked to say, who in this cat coming against me?
All right.
David said, wait a minute. When you fight me, you don't fight just fight me.
Come on now.
I'm in covenant with God.
Yeah.
And if you fight me, you gotta fight God too. Haley. family affair.
Yes, sir.
Giant, but it's gonna be the word of God. Bible said he took his staff.
Yes. Yes.
He grabbed the stone.
Uh-huh.
Put the stone in his bag.
Yes.
But when he went to face Goliath, he kept the word in his hand.
Yes.
The word. Those things that be watch this. When David killed him, all Goliath's homies took off running.
Yes, they did.
All his homeboys took off. They got out of Dodge, baby. Watch this. While they were running, David took the sword of his enemy, cut off his enemy's head, picked it up, and showed everybody how to get ahead in life. Join my faith with this body of believers and be a part of what God is doing